Well, good morning, everyone. And welcome to worship at Belhelvie, and a particular welcome if you're new to being back in church. It's great to have you along today, and a particular welcome to the family of Stuart and Nicola Youngson, whose baby boy, Bobby, is being baptised today. So it's great to have you folks along and some of your family and friends today. And we're only sorry that more couldn't have been with us. But I was saying to Stephen down at the back, it's a wee bit like Tetris, trying to get everybody fitted into the pews. And hello to the folks up the stairs. Thank you for your forbearance in going upstairs. Might even be slightly warmer up there. I hope it's not too warm today. So we're going to begin our worship this morning in the words of a video hymn. It's going to appear on the screen, and it's called Come Now Is the Time to Worship. And we'll stand and join in with this song.
Time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are. Time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are.
Let's take a moment to pray together now. Let's pray. God, we bless you this morning that while the scriptures speak of your power and your justice and your mercy, they say much more when it comes to your love. They say not just that you show love, but that you are love, that somehow love is of your very essence. And we struggle to understand this. Our motives are always so mixed, and our good intentions often bound up with self-interest. And yet now and again we catch glimpses of that pure essence of love, and it almost always moves us. The tired mother smiling as she cradles her newborn baby. The wee children laughing and playing with each other with that lovely, unquestioning acceptance. The pride that we feel as we watch a friend or a family member get the recognition they deserve for their hard work. The trembling couple holding each other's gaze as they take their vows before a hushed congregation. The kind friend who reads our mind and our moods well enough to know when to speak and when just to leave us alone. The selfless carer, going the extra mile day after day with no thought of reward. God, we glimpse something of who you are in these human stories, but we still can't begin to understand what it means that you are love and that you look upon your world with the eyes of love and demonstrated the depth of your love by coming to live and die and rise again amongst us in the person of your Son, Jesus Christ. Your love rests upon us this morning, whoever we are and however we are. That is the truth. But Lord, we know how terribly easy it is to take love for granted. We see it all the time as spouses, parents, children, and friends grow used to one another. Assumptions are made, conversation dies, distance grows, and love can wither on the vine. We ask you to forgive us when we slip into patterns of behavior that take people for granted, most especially you and all that you did for us in the incarnation and on the cross. Lord, waken us up if we are sleepwalking through life, presuming on you or those around us. Help us find that spark of vitality that makes life worth living and makes the days sweeter for having known you in the midst of them. So hear our prayers, because we ask them all in the name of Jesus, our friend and our Saviour. And in his name we pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever. Our reading this morning is taken from John's Gospel, John chapter 3, and reading verses 14 to 17.
No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Amen.
Let's pray together now. Oh Lord, we can't lift up our voices, at least not for a week or two yet, but we can lift up our minds, our hearts, our intellect, our understanding, so that you might speak a word to us this morning, and not only that you would speak it, that we would hear it. So open our ears, open our minds to your word and to your understanding, and bring it home to our hearts and minds, that we might more truly know you and more truly follow you and serve you. Because we ask it in Christ's name. Amen. So the football season's almost over. Trophies have been lifted. Tears have been shed, and the transfer rumour mill is already grinding away with next season in view. But before then, there is this small matter of Euro 2020, which, in keeping with these confusing times, is taking place in 2021. And even more confusingly, appears to involve the Scotland football team. I realise I haven't got a leg to stand on throwing stones at the Scots, because Northern Ireland didn't even make it past the qualifying rounds. But it's great that Scotland are there after all these years of waiting. So there's going to be a feast of international football to enjoy, or maybe to avoid, if that's not your thing, over the next couple of months. And of course, we've got a Lions rugby tour of South Africa coming up as well. Now, when I was a kid and I was watching the World Cup or the Euros, there was nearly always somebody in the crowd who had smuggled a banner or a placard into the stadium saying John 3:16. And that's all it said. And I guess the hope was that curious folk might realize it was a Bible verse and go and look it up to see what it actually said. But why this one verse out of the tens of thousands of verses that could have been chosen? Well, I guess it's because for many people, there's no better summary of the message of the whole gospel. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. It's all there. The Father, the Son, the problem, the solution, and the promise. And that's part of the reason that this particular verse is probably the best known in Scripture. But like everything else that's overfamiliar to us, we can become almost immune to its real meaning. So over the next few weeks, we're going to take our time and look carefully at each part of this verse to see what Jesus is really saying through these words that John records for us. And we're going to begin this morning with, "For God so loved the world." Those six words will do us for today. And it's only recently that I've realized that I've been reading those six words wrongly for my whole adult life. I've always taken that "so," "for God so loved the world," as a "so" of emphasis. God so loved the world. He really, really loved it, which he did. But that's not actually what the Greek says. The Greek says, "for thus God loved the world." In other words, in this way, this is the way that God loved the world, by sending his Son. If you ask me how to set the table for dinner, and I show you, and as I'm doing it, I say, "just so," you know what I mean? I mean, it's done in this way. This is how it's done. And that's what Jesus is saying here. He's saying, this is how God loved the world. This is how it was done, by the sending of his one and only Son. And we'll think more about what that means in the weeks to come. But having cleared up that minor point, I want us to pause and ask ourselves a much more important question. Do we really believe that God loves the world? It trips off the tongue. But do we really believe it? Or do we have doubts in the back of our mind? Looking around at some of the things that go on in the world, we might well wonder what God makes of it and if he loves it. And we probably know enough of the biblical story to know that there's plenty in Scripture that could call God's love for the world into question. So does God love the world? It's not an easy question to answer, and Christians answer it in different ways. Go into any church and listen discerningly to the hymns and the prayers and the sermon, and you'll pretty soon work out where they're coming from. Is the world something essentially good to celebrate, or is it something essentially bad to tolerate as we make our way to heaven? We'll see you in a wee minute, Bobby. Is the world the object of God's love, or is the world the object of God's wrath? And arguments could be made either way from the scriptures. And as I've puzzled over that, I found myself drawing an analogy with my studies in chemistry from days long back gone by, and I have to say, trying to help Isla with her chemistry has reminded me how much of my chemistry I have forgotten. But when you first start doing chemistry, you're told that an atom is like a little solar system. In the middle, there's the nucleus with the protons and the neutrons, and orbiting around them on the outside are the electrons. So it looks like a wee mini solar system. It's all very black and white and nice and simple. Once you get that into your head and you think you've got it sussed, they start telling you that the electrons don't move in nice little orbits like the planets, but they buzz about so quickly that you can't even take a snapshot of them. You don't know where they are at any one time. And if you were able to plot the movements of the electrons, they would look more like a cloud than anything else. And just when you think you've got that in your head, they start telling you that most of an atom is actually space. If an atom were the size of Wembley Football Stadium, the nucleus would be the size of a pea at the center spot of the pitch. That's how small the nucleus is. Most of an atom is space. And it's whenever you learn that these are the smallest particles, the neutron, the electron, the proton, but actually they now know that that's far from the case. There are subatomic particles called quarks, and it's some of these most elusive quarks that the scientists at CERN in Switzerland are trying to detect with the giant Meccano set that they call the Large Hadron Collider. Now, it's not that that simple model of the atom that we were taught at school didn't have some truth or some value in it. It did. It explained a lot, and it helped us take our first steps into science. But the simplicity of that first model had a far more wonderful and complicated set of truths that it's taken us a long time to understand. And for me, that's a helpful model of how to understand the revelation of God that we see in Scripture. When we read these passages in the Old Testament that are very black and white, that suggests that God loves Israel and hates all the other nations, or that God loves the good people and hates the bad people, well, that's nice and simple, having things that black and white. But we now know that there's much more to the story than that. Not least because Jesus showed us so and told us so. As you read through the Old Testament and into the New, it's clear that the writers are becoming more and more aware of the wideness of God's mercy. That God has designed not just a one chosen set of people, but on the whole of creation. And in these words that we have before us today, we hear categorically from the mouth of the Son of God the most amazing, beautiful truth that's spoken with the authority of the only one who actually knows the truth. And he says, "For God so loved the world." Whatever else we might need to say about judgment or about sin or about wrong, and there's a lot to be said, God's fundamental orientation towards this world, even in its ambiguity, is love. For God so loved the world. Now I want you to think about someone or something that you love for a moment. Could be a person, could be a place, it could be land that you farm, it could be a pet who's been in the family for a long time, it could be a spouse or a parent or a child or a friend. And ask yourself this question: why do I love them? Why do I love them? At its simplest, isn't it because in some sense you belong to one another? You've worked that land and you've lived on it. You've cared for that pet. You've shared your life with that person. You belong to one another, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health. And what is it that you want for them as a result of that love? Isn't it that they'll flourish and that your connection with them will grow stronger and deeper? And will your love fail when things go wrong, when they don't quite go to plan? Well, sometimes hard things have to be said or face up to. Wrongs have to be addressed and made right. Things have to be worked through. And sometimes it isn't always possible to work them through. But love toughs it out. It always hopes, always trusts, always protects, and always perseveres, as the Apostle Paul said. As I've reminded you a few times recently in the parable of the prodigal son, the father who's left at home as his son travels off to the big city to squander his life never stops loving that boy for a moment, even when he just makes all the wrong choices. Those choices break his father's heart, but they don't diminish the father's love for that boy one iota. Not one iota. He never stops loving him. And this is how God loves the world that he formed. Through his own free choice, he has bound himself to us in love. And he won't rest until the innate, God-given goodness of all things is set free from everything that would constrain and mar it. And because God is generous and good and full of grace, this divine love is set on everyone and everything. For God so loved the world, says Jesus. And the word translated world in the Greek is cosmos, from which we get our English word cosmos. Jesus is telling us that God loves the entire cosmos, the whole created order. People, animals, plant life, earth, stars, moon, and suns is all held within his love. Professor Willie Barclay puts it this way. He said it was the world that God so loved. It was not a nation. It was not the good people. It was not only the people who loved him. It was the world. The unlovable and the unlovely, the lonely who have no one else to love them, those who love God and those who never think of him, those who rest in the love of God and those who spurn it, all are included in this vast, inclusive love of God. Even those who think they're beyond the pale, or others, or who others think perhaps are beyond the pale, are included. That doesn't mean there isn't work to be done in their lives, far from it, but the starting point is one of inclusion. I know I've told this story many times, but I think like all good stories, it bears repeating. The story's told of a soldier whose conscience was troubling him, and he went to visit a monk to make his confession, and he said, "Can God ever forgive me for all the wrong things that I've done in life?" "Tell me," said the monk, "when your cloak is torn, do you throw it away?" "No," said the soldier, "I mend it and I use it again." "Well, if you're that careful with your cloak," said the monk, "don't you think God will be just as careful with his creatures?" I believe that God is careful with his creatures, that God truly loves what he has made. And that might be easy for us to believe as we look out to the sea or to the hills on a gorgeous sunny day. You might need to go north or south of Balmedy to see the sun. And it might feel real and true when you look into the faces of the people that you love and all is well with the world. But it's harder to believe when we watch the news or we find ourselves going through a tough patch in life. But it's no less true even then. For God so loved the world, said Jesus, the whole world, the cosmos. He loved it so much that he wills its redemption. He wants to make things as they were always intended to be. Whether the cosmos will let itself be redeemed is a whole other story. But we'll hear more about that in the weeks to come. But for now, these six words are enough for us to take away and to think about in the week. For God so loved the world. Amen. Eric Leslie is going to come now and lead us in our prayers for others.
Please join me in prayer. Let us pray. Our loving Heavenly Father, we come before you in constant wonder that you, the Creator of all things, would choose to be with us in this place this morning. We give our thanks for all good things that you have brought us this week, for the increasingly long days, for the growth in fields and gardens, and for the beauty of your creation which surrounds us. Today, we especially give you our thanks for the words we heard from John, which reaffirms that you love the whole world. We are blessed in the knowledge that your love is not reserved for certain people in particular places, but extends to all people in all places, even to those who choose to willfully reject your love. Forgive us, Lord, when we continue to stray from your path and commit sins for which your Son died on the cross. We are blessed that despite repeated mistakes born out of our humanity, you continue to long for our return to you. It is in this knowledge that we make the following prayers for others. We bring to you our minister and his family. We thank you for them and for all they do for us. Bless them and help us to encourage them in their work for you, both within and out with this place. We pray that you be with our session clerk, church elders, committee conveners, and group supervisors. Give us the strength to grow in you and to emulate your love in the places we are. We ask that you be with members of our congregation and our parish, many of whom we know are grieving from the loss of loved ones, and who are caring for the sick and elderly, or who themselves are suffering from illness. Give them comfort and strength through knowing you are with them always. We raise to you those in our part of the world and beyond who are in need, those without enough to eat or drink, or without a roof over their heads, victims of racism and abusive relationships, those who are worried about money and employment. Lord, let your love and presence be known to them such that they will have real hope that their situations will improve. We pray for strength to do what we can, where we can, to help improve their situations. We ask that you be with the leaders of our country as they continue to deliberate over the decisions which are so important to those at home and abroad. Help them to use the time they have wisely and to ensure they act in the interest of those they serve rather than through self-interest. We bring to you all those people in places where the coronavirus continues to escalate with little hope of improvement in the near future. Please be with the leaders and decision makers of the richest nations who we pray will act in unison to provide vital COVID-19 vaccines to poorer countries and help save countless lives. Finally, Lord, we bless the Youngson and Barron families on this very special day for little Bobby. And in doing so, we pray that we all remember our own baptisms and continue to strive to live our lives in keeping with them. We ask these things in the precious name of your Son and our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Well, is that better, Bobby? I think you've got your mummy's red hair. You have. Nicola and Stuart and Ellie and Lucy, we are so pleased to welcome you here today to church along with your friends and your family to celebrate Bobby's baptism. So, girl, boy, okay. Now, you could go two ways with that, right? You could stick, because you've covered all the bases now, okay? Or you could twist just to even up the gender balance in the family, if you felt so inclined. The choice is yours, but girl, boy. Down in Glasgow, they used to say if you got a boy and a girl as your first two children, that was called a gentleman's family. So when we had a boy and a girl, I used to say, well, if you tell me who that gentleman is, I'll happily package them up and send them off to... No, they were great kids. So, Bobby Stuart Youngson. That's a good name. I don't want to tempt fate, but to me that sounds like a good farmer's name, Bobby Stuart Youngson. Who did you rent your grass to? Oh, Bobby Youngson. Who did you get your low loader from? Bobby Youngson. I think that just fits with him. And I guess only time will tell whether his life will take him in that direction, but it certainly sounds like you've chosen a good name for him. And as we baptize Bobby this morning, we remember that God has chosen a name for your son too. And you read a wee bit about that in the book of Revelation. Jesus says, to him who overcomes, I will give a white stone with a new name written on it, known only to him who receives it, which is very mysterious. And Revelation is quite a hard book to understand, but here's what I think that image means. I think the name on that stone is the name of our truest self. It's the person that we already are in God's imagination, and that one day, by the grace of God, we will become. And your task as the parents and the family and friends of this child, and ours as a church that's welcoming Bobby into our community, is to help him to grow into his true name, to help him become all that God wants him to become. We all want the best for our kids, and when we stop and really think about it, we know that that's not just material things, and you know this. It's things like health and happiness, good, strong friendships and family life, work that you enjoy, but also time to get away from it now and again. Faith, hope, and love, these are the things that matter and that give meaning to a life. And we're here today in church, week in and week out, because we believe that giving God his place in our lives is helping us become more and more the people that he wants us to be. If you had to boil it all down to one sentence, baptism is the church's way of saying to your wee one, God is there for you, Bobby. And it's our hope that as he grows into maturity, that he'll be able to make his own response to that when the time is right and be able to say, yes, God, and I'm here for you too. So with that, can I ask you folks to come and gather around the font now and we'll baptize Bobby. And I'll scoosh my hands. So this will be a wee bit different because I'm not allowed to hold the baby. So this will be interesting. Have you been delegated, Nicola, right? So, yeah, okay. Do you want to just hold him in your arms over the font? Yeah, that way, that's great. If you put it, lovely, that's great. Welcome, welcome. This happened to you, and this happened to you. You don't remember it, do you? But this happened to you. Hello, Bobby. I shouldn't touch you, but I will. Hello. Bobby, for you, Jesus left his father's side. For you, he lived a fully human life. For you, he died on Calvary's tree, and for you, he rose again and conquered death. And all this he did for you, even though at the moment you don't know one thing about it. So in his name, we welcome you into the worldwide family of the Christian church. Bobby Stuart Youngson, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. May God be with you. What a wee star. That's very good. Well done, Bobby. Okay, thank you, folks. Okay, do you want to just stand down here for now? Well done. Nicola and Stuart, in presenting Bobby for baptism, I'm required to ask you the following questions. Do you want Bobby to learn about Jesus Christ, to know his forgiveness, to share his love and follow in his way. Do you believe in one God, the Father of us all, who came to live among us in Jesus Christ the Son, and who's present with us now in the Holy Spirit? And do you promise to bring Bobby to church as God enables you and with his help, so he can hear the good news of the gospel and grow in the love of God and in the service of other people? Thank you. And you, the congregation of this church and the friends and family of this child, do you promise to care for Bobby, to make your homes in this church a place of welcome, and to show your love to him in a kindly and a Christian way? If you can make those promises, will you now please stand? This is the point where Stuart and Nicola would normally walk around the church with the baby so you can get a wee look at Bobby. We can't do that, but we are going to sing "The Lord Bless You and Keep You" for him. So just as the youngsters are getting back into their pew, I think we should give them a round of applause and welcome Bobby into the church. And girls from the Sunday school, that's a wee present for, yes, I know it's for you. It's for Ellie and for Lucy and for Bobby. There's a wee book in there for you. So I'll give those to Dad so he can look after them. Okay. You are very welcome, darling. You're very welcome. Nicola and Stuart, your son belonged to God before today, but from now on, he will always be welcomed within the Christian community, and there will always be a place for him, not just within this church, but within every church. So as he grows up, tell him about his baptism, so when the time comes, he can make his own response to what we've done in faith today. Let's pray together now. Father in heaven, we want to thank you this morning for the gift of this little life, for Bobby's safe arrival into the world and all the joy that he's brought to Stuart and Nicola and the rest of the family. And in these special moments, as we celebrate the present and look ahead to the possibilities that lie before him, we want to pause and commit ourselves to his welfare, asking for your strength to fulfill the promises that we've made today. We pray for Stuart and Nicola. We ask that you'd give them all the resources of love and patience and wisdom that they need to give Bobby the best possible start in life. Help them when it's tough to be a parent, when their duties at work and at home tire them out and feel burdensome. And bless them in the good times, when having children feels like a joy and a privilege, and each day is brightened by some new discovery that they're making. Help us as we can to support them in practical ways, being there when they need a helping hand or a listening ear, so they don't feel that they're facing these challenges alone. Help us to play our part in nurturing this young life and helping him become all that he can be in body, soul, heart, and mind. May this church be a place of welcome and warmth for him, and this community an environment in which he feels at home. So hear these and all our silent hopes and prayers, because we offer them all through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We close our service now in the words of our final hymn, number 636, "Baptized in Water."
Thank you.
And now go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forevermore.